Tanay, Tummalapalli. I have a hard to pronounce last name, so you can just call me TT. That works. I recently graduated in August and I finished my Google Summer of Code with Apache Beam in September. And right now I'm interning at a startup in Bangalore. And before that, I interned at a Singaporean startup based out of New Delhi called Social Cops. And I'll be talking about stream processing fundamentals with Apache Beam. These are general concepts that apply to all stream processing tools or frameworks, but we'll be looking at some pseudocode written with keeping Apache Beam in mind. And yeah, we'll be looking at an example problem and then working iteratively towards a solution with Apache Beam. So you can reach out to me on any of these handles. So the example problem we'll be looking at is, for example, 2048, where you've built an amazing and addictive game and you want to look at any metrics. The business team needs some metrics to make some decisions because science, and they want to look at a metrics, for example, like how many points does the user score, say, per every 2 minute. So that here would be when two tiles merge, the user gets points then. So how would we go about calculating that? So it's fairly easy when you start out. You'll have a simple CRUD application and you can easily get those metrics with running aggregations. And as you scale, your aggregation pipeline will get blocked and then it will slow up. But then you can add indexes and then you can then apply all the standard scaling solutions. You can shard your database and then etc. You can do batch processing. But then eventually you'll have to move to an event-based system where your ingestion is through an event log, for example, something like Kafka or any other. Apache Pulsar is also a really good new project. You can use something like that. And then you'll start hitting bottlenecks and then eventually you'll have to do stream processing at some point of time. So the problem would look something like this, where the user scores points at 8 o'clock and for some reason, for example, network problems or the user's device went offline or any other problem, or your system could not receive the event or something. So you'll receive events out of order and they'll be infinite because it's a stream, and you would receive them out of order. And then you'll have events that happened at 8, but they show up much later at say 2:30 or something. And then your aggregations at 9 are inconsistent with what the actual system looks like. So we'll solve this problem with Apache Beam and yeah, we'll work incrementally towards the solution. So what is Apache Beam? Apache Beam is basically a programming model that enables you to write batch and stream processing jobs, and they can run on any execution engine like Spark, Flink, etc. And it has three main features which are unified, which means you can treat batch and stream data as the same. You can write a single processing job for both of them. And you can run it on any execution engine. So you write your data pipeline once and it will run on say Spark, Flink or Google Cloud Dataflow, anyone. And it's extensible, which means you can create your own SDKs, you can create your own IO connectors and basically extend that code and do anything with it. So the core of Apache Beam is something called the Apache Beam model, which is used to model data pipelines while writing them with Apache Beam. So to understand the Beam model, first we need to make a distinction between bounded and unbounded data or batch and streaming data. Batch and streaming data is an inaccurate term to use for these types of data because The batch and stream just mean how you're processing them. They don't necessarily characterize how the data is. An accurate term to use would be bound. So bounded data would be your typically batch data where it ends, and unbounded data is your streaming data where it is infinite, it's not bounded. So batch or bounded data is just your streaming data at one point in time. And they're not different, they're more or less just the same. Another distinction we need to make is between event time and processing time. As you can see here, x-axis is event time and y-axis is processing time. Event time is defined as the time at which an event happens. This, in our example, would be 8 a.m. And processing time is when we actually process the data. And as you can see, the dotted line is the ideal line when we process events as they happen, which is clearly not possible because you'll eventually have late data and out of order data. And the red line is what actually happens where we process events much later than when they happen. And this is what we call a watermark, which is a notion of input completeness with respect to event times. What this means is that at one point of time, at one xy, we declare that all event times lower than that particular event time have been observed by the system, and it does not expect any other event with a timestamp lower than that particular timestamp, which is with the watermark. And there are two types of watermarks that are generally used. One is a perfect watermark and the other is a heuristic watermark. A perfect watermark would exist when we have perfect knowledge of a system and its data, when it's actually not possible, because then you'll have to have perfect knowledge, which in a distributed system is very rare and in fact impossible. And so we generally end up with a heuristic based watermark, and this watermark is used by your data processing pipeline or job to decide when one stage of a pipeline is complete and the next one should start executing. And if this watermark is too slow, your results will be delayed because then the downstream operations will not be performed. So your system will hold up because your watermark is too slow. And if the watermark is too fast, which means that it will declare that an upstream operation completed when in fact it still had some data to process. In that case, you'll have data that will arrive which was supposed to be processed by that upstream operation, and that would be called late data. Late data is fairly common in stream processing, and we'll look at how we'll handle late data. We'll talk more about watermarks later. So we'll use these four core questions to understand the beam model. What results are calculated? Where in event time are results calculated? When in processing time are results materialized? And how do refinements of results relate? Don't bother about this much. I'll talk more about them. So what are we calculating? So this, if you've written a data processing job anytime, you'll know that what you're processing is defined by a graph or a directed acyclic graph, and this will be expressed with the help of two things called P transforms and P collections. The P here stands for parallel, which means that since it's a distributed system, these P collections can be on multiple systems and they'll be processed keeping that in mind. So P collection is a distributed data set across which parallel transformations may be performed, and the parallel transformation that will be performed is called a P transform. And these P transforms can be of three major types: element wise, where each individual element will be processed separately, this can be stateless, and aggregating, where multiple elements in a data set are required for each result. And for this, you'll need to maintain state. And composite, which is a combination of both element wise and aggregating. And in Beam, it would look something like this, where since this is a Python conference, we'll use Python to write pseudocode for it. So with beam.pipeline as P, we basically declare a pipeline, and this is a context manager. So when the context ends, it will run the pipeline and wait for the result. And here we are reading from a source, which is our input stream, and then calculating the sum per key, where our key would be the user ID. So here we are basically just summing over the points scored by a user. Now we need to calculate the points scored by a user every 2 minutes, which this is not doing. This is just calculating the total score. So we'll look at how. So where is implemented by windowing, where it separates out partitions data into chunks that are based on event time. So as we discussed, event time is when the event actually happened. So the x-axis is the event time, and we're separating them into different partitions. And as you can see, they all have different sums. So here we've sort of reached a solution where, as you can see, every 2 minutes, we're getting the sum of user points. But here again, we're not catering to late data, because here we're waiting for the entire of the 12 to 1202 window to end to then process the next ones. So windows are of three major types. Fixed windows is what we were using earlier. Sliding windows, where you have something like you want metrics for the last 24 hours or something. And session windows is where you can have a certain data point determine when the window ends or starts. So something like a user session would be a typical example here, where you want to track metrics for when a session ends and starts. And this is how the code would look. So the pipe operator that is being used there is used to declare downstream operations. So P is the pipeline object, and with P pipe read, we declare that read is a downstream operation to the pipeline. So since P is the initial object, read would be the first node in the pipeline DAG. And then we introduce a downstream operation window into, where we're declaring that we want fixed windows of 2 minutes. And then we have the sum operation. And that's how we get the scores per 2 minutes per user. Now, when in processing time our results materialize. So when we have late data, we need to also use watermarks or triggers or something to know when in processing time we should get the results, because the events happen at the same time, but it's the processing time that's different for all of them. So as we discussed, watermarks is nothing but a timestamp that tells the system data up to this timestamp has been processed by the system, and this is used in to declare which data has been processed in the DAG. And so there are, as I said, there are two types of watermarks, perfect and heuristic. Perfect watermark is when you have perfect knowledge of the system and data. So here we know we won't observe the 9 user score until 1208, and only then we are then processing the subsequent windows. So here we know that 9 is going to occur there, when in fact in practicality we won't know. So then we have something called the heuristic watermark, which then declares that okay, I've seen 5 as the input, and there are not going to be any other events for the same event time. So then we've basically dropped the 9 event, which is something we might not want, or we may want in some cases. So we look at how to get that 9 into our aggregation. So triggers are used to declare when output for a window are emitted in processing time. So what this means is that we dropped 9, but what if we wanted our aggregation to reflect that 9 occurred? So there are three basic types of triggers: on time, early firing, and late firing. On time is the standard default trigger, and early firing one is when it says that I'm going to see more input, but here is an early result of what has already occurred. And then 14, in the first diagram, 14 is the on time trigger, where it says the watermark closes, and then it has triggered the input for it. And then there's the late trigger. Firing is basically when a trigger occurs, when the results are materialized, and when the on time trigger occurs, and if there's data that arrives after that, then it's a late trigger. As you can see in the second diagram, the first window for 9, then it treats it as a late trigger when we're using a heuristic watermark. Now, since we're using stateful operations, we cannot store state forever. So at some point of time, we'll need to discard state, because then we'll eventually run out of memory. So allowed lateness basically tells the system when to discard state. For example, here 9 is a late event that we get, but we've already stored state for so long, so we might run out of memory, and it may not be critical to have 9 in our final result. So here we end up dropping 9, because then our lateness horizon has crossed. So we say, so here we define lateness horizon as 12 to 1202 for this window, because there we don't want to store state for later. And allowed lateness is in beam allows us to define this behavior, and it is defined as the latest timestamp up to which the state needs to be stored, and after that it will drop that particular data. And here's what the code would look like for it, where we have the trigger defined after the watermark has completed, and then we define the firings for it. This is not actual code, this is pseudo code. You'll have to still write the import statements and other stuff, but you'll get the hang of it once you go through this. And Apache Beam has really good documentation and code examples and everything. You can find it on the internet. And so the fourth question is how. When we have all this late data and we know that we have to materialize the results after a certain point, now how do we relate those materializations of the results? So if you have two events that were late, and one was later than the first late one, how would you end up relating them? So there are three basic accumulation modes. When you have multiple late data, you can accumulate them and process them together. So that would be something like the second case, where we first had 5 and then we have 9. So the accumulated result sum for that first window is 14. And then you also have discarding, which is the first diagram, where the first event was 5 in that window, and then we get 9. So we discard the first one and then only consider the second event in that particular window. And something which is more complicated is accumulating and retracting, which basically says that the result you got earlier is wrong and here is the correct result. So then it provides you with the correct result, which is accumulated. And retractions are not implemented in Beam yet. They're soon to come. And this would be the code for it. Accumulation mode dot accumulating. You can specify the mode there. And this is basically your simple data pipeline to calculate user scores per 2 minute windows. And here you also cater to late data. Those are the basic concepts. I think if you go through Apache Beam, you'll the documentation. There are more concepts, but these are the basics that will cover majorly everything. And Apache Beam also has a lot of SDKs. It has a Java SDK, Go SDK, and Python SDK. And it also is available as Beam SQL. And as I said, you can run it on any execution engine. You can run it on Google Cloud Dataflow, Apache Spark, or Flink, and it works. And Spark, for the Python SDK, Spark is currently batch only, and Flink and Spark both are something called portable runners, where it under the hood runs your Python pipeline using Java, because all the runners are written in Java. But yeah, you can also do multi-language pipelines where, for example, you have a Java pipeline and you want to specify one operation with a Python function or something. So that's also possible. And yeah, you can do machine learning with it. You can write data analytics pipelines. You can do n number of things. And if you want to look at cool use cases, there's something called the Beam Summit that happens quite frequently. And especially Lyft has really good talks there. They have a really interesting use case. So you can go through that. And some resources that I would recommend are the World Beyond Batch 101 and 102 Blocks by Tyler Akida, who actually wrote this book, Streaming Systems. And these two blogs are the basis for the book as well as the Beam model. And then it also has really good documentation. And if you want to get started with Apache Beam, all the concepts are really well outlined in the programming guide. And if you're really interested in diving deep, then I'd recommend reading the Streaming Systems book. And yeah, get involved. We don't have a lot of contributors from the Asia Pacific or this region in the world. So yeah, get involved. And if you use Apache Beam or want to use Apache Beam or maybe contribute or anything, just cash me outside. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, Tanay, for the talk.
Questions?
I'll open a few up to questions. Are there any questions?
So Apache Beam, one application I really find interesting is how Lyft uses it. So Lyft's dynamic user pricing, that entire calculation is done using Beam. And I'm not a machine learning engineer. I haven't done a lot of machine learning, so I don't understand it that much. But they use machine learning and use stream processing using Apache Beam and Flink. And their pricing model is based on that. And otherwise, Beam also is used extensively by anyone who's running data pipelines in production. And yeah, you can do cool analytics with it. So if you're using Spark for anything, Spark streaming, you can do the same with Apache Beam. And I know a lot of people in a local meetup group in Bangalore where they wrote their data pipelines in Flink and they ended up moving them to Beam because Beam is like this wrapper over all the execution frameworks where it provides you with multiple tools and utilities that you can then use with execution engines like Spark, Flink. So Flink would not have a lot of utilities and things implemented, but if you use Beam on Flink, you can then use all the extra utilities that were written for Beam. And you can also use them with Spark, and you get the idea. So yeah.
Hey, hi. I'd like to ask quite a fundamental question because I'm not very familiar in this space. So what will we lose if we choose not to use Beam? Because I don't understand what exactly is the additional advantage of Beam.
So if let's assume that you're not using Beam, so your infrastructure would look something like you're running Flink, and you're then limited to writing your data pipelines in Java and Scala, and to a certain extent Python, and your infra would still look the same because Flink can then run on Kubernetes, and then you can dockerize your application and everything. But where you'll then end up having the bottleneck is actually writing business logic for it, because then you'll end up implementing a lot of the same utilities that are already present in Beam. And if, say, you want to run Spark streaming as well as Flink and you want to experiment, then you'll have to set up the entire thing again, where in fact if you just use Beam, you can write your data pipeline once, run anywhere. So yeah, it's a wrapper over all of the execution engines.
Right, are there any more questions? Hi, I'm Ola. Not sure if the question makes sense or not, but like, does it integrate with Airflow, or like, how does it play together there?
So Airflow is in a different space. Airflow is batch only, where it provides a scheduler and then it can maintain dependencies and then process it. But so you can do batch processing with Beam as well, because Beam treats batch and streaming as the same. But what Beam does not do is provide you with a scheduler to do that. So say you want to do batch processing and you want to write it in Beam, you can do that. It works perfectly fine, but then you need a scheduler to schedule those Beam pipelines. So if you, are you familiar with Airflow? So with Airflow, you can define your entire DAG, and then you can define your schedule. So in terms of Airflow, if you would want to isolate what Apache Beam does, your entire DAG definition would be a Beam pipeline. And then you can specify a schedule with Airflow, and then it would run your Beam pipeline. So a Beam pipeline is an encapsulation over your entire DAG.
Okay,
I got a question. Sorry, here. How do you compare Beam and Kafka?
So Kafka is an append-only log for ingestion. So you can store your data as events in it, and then you can process those events with Kafka consumers, or you can use a stateful stream processing engine, something like Flink. So with Flink or Beam, they more or less do the same thing. With a stream processor, you'll be able to do much more than what you would be able to do with just a Kafka consumer. So a Kafka consumer, you would not be able to have multiple dependencies over it, and then you can't consume multiple topics with the same consumer. So also a Kafka consumer can be loosely an input to your pipeline, and then it can have multiple actions. So multiple operations. So with a Beam pipeline, think of it as a Kafka consumer and then some operations, downstream operations. I hope that answers your question.
Okay, can I consider Kafka is also a type of engines, and Beam can also be a wrapper to Kafka?
Not exactly. So Kafka, talking in terms of streams and tables, Kafka is a stream, and it's basically data in motion, because at one point of time you can't just query your entire Kafka cluster and get all the data that's there in it. But traditionally with a database where data is stored in a table, you can query it at one point of time and you'll get a correct result. So that's fundamentally where Kafka is different, is because it's useful for ingestion, because then you have your entire data as events in a stream fashion, and Beam would help you to process it. Kafka consumer can also do the same thing, but in my understanding, Beam provides you with much more than just that. For example, all the windowing functions and triggers and all these extra stuff that Beam has, or even something like Flink has, you won't be able to do that with just a Kafka consumer.
So that could be the what KSQL is doing, right?
I'm not very familiar with KSQL. Could you give a maybe introduction to KSQL?
I'm not ready to do that because I'm also exploring the what is the best the streaming tool to be used. I did evaluate the Spark Stream and also look at the Apache Kafka. Yes, okay, KSQL is the one of the option given to us. Yeah, it's also back to understand more about the Apache Beam.
So, correct me if I'm wrong, KSQL, does it provide an SQL interface so you can query your, so you can process your Kafka top cluster?
Yes, it's kind of you can. It's on top of the consumer. It's just that you can use a SQL framework to write your business logics and to process the data on an event-driven basis.
So I'm not very familiar with KSQL clearly. So I don't know what it actually is. So I won't be able to answer that part of the question. But yeah, Kafka consumers are limited in what you can do. You can write, you can still do something like read from Kafka and then write to something like BigQuery with simple processing in between, but you'll not be able to write complex DAGs for it, which you can do with Beam. And yeah, if you something like Gojek has this thing, a project called Beast, where they do something similar, where they read from Kafka and then write to BigQuery with some processing in between. Those cases can be done with Kafka consumers, but for something more complex, you'll need a stateful stream processor, either Spark Structured Streaming or Flink, or Beam is essentially the same, but just is a wrapper over it. So, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Thank you for sharing.
Thank you.
Right, we have time for one more question.
I'm new to Beam, so maybe it's not so relevant, probably. What's the kind of data source format do you recommend for Beam? Is like a tabular column format or like PyCon or something? Would that be appropriate?
So Beam has an abstract representation of a source. So it has something called an unbounded source, where as we saw, you can represent unbounded data. And for something like a Parquet file or something, Apache Beam has bounded sources where it basically just reads those files. And it still has some logic that is common in bounded and unbounded sources. And there's something called this splittable do function. You can look that up, and that is basically how Beam reads bounded and unbounded sources. So that SDF logic is the same for both of them, but they are different abstract classes for them. And Apache Beam also has a large collection of IO connectors. So Avro, Parquet, and all these data sources have IO connectors in Beam. So you can just use those in your data pipeline. So you won't need to write custom logic. But if you want, you can.
So which one do you recommend? Like, which one faster pops stream?
Which one out of?
Avro or Parquet?
It would depend on your use case. Thank you.
Right, thank you.
Thank you.
Round of applause for Tanay for